Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Isabel Whiteleg. I'm the curator of the public programme here at Nottingham Contemporary. And I'm here to welcome you, principally, to the theory of Zappa, which was devised in relationship to the exhibition upstairs by Geoffrey Farmer, entitled Let's Make the Water Turn Black. And the relationship to Frank Zappa, the relationship that work has to Frank Zappa, if I can explain it in simple terms for now, is that the different light changes, audio tracks, and program movements of the sculptures within that work relate to different moments of history as measured by the six decades of the life of Frank Zappa. It's putting it quite simply. And the change unpredictability of the piece also relates perhaps to the theories of time and space that sculpted the structures of position, and that have also shaped the theory of Zappa, or Zappology even, as an interdisciplinary field operating both inside and outside of academia. I wanted to put together an event on the theory of Zappa, but I am the theory of Zappa. So I would like to thank very much Paul Carr, who is really the author of the event and the person who invited the two guests beside him. Paul is head of the Division of Music and Sound and Reader in Popular Music Analysis at the Atrium, University of Glamorgan. He's also editor of Frank Zappa and the Anne, freshly published anthology and scholar. And I'm so pleased to say that the book is here and available for purchase at a special I'm going to shortly hand over all to an introduction to the beginning of this event and guests. Richard Hemmings, media drama and culture. Industries, who will speak about Zappa's discourse, followed by mission after Richard, I'm told. Ability. So, to Paul, a rundown of the structure of things. Paul will give a quick intro, and then each speaker will speak for 20 minutes. And then we will assemble for a discussion, which we have approximately half an hour for. I'll ask a couple of questions just to warm things up, and then we'll have time to take questions from the audience. So on that note, I'll hand over to Paul. Thanks.
Thanks, Isabel. I'll just quickly get my presentation up. Yeah, thanks, Isabel, and thank you to everybody for showing up. It's great to see such a large number of people turn up to the event. And I think it's really poignant that these discussions are taking place as we reach the 20th anniversary of Zappa's death, which is coming up on December the 4th. So it's great that the installation and this event is actually taking place at this point in time. It's interesting with Zappa because 20 years down the line, it's fascinating to see that he is eventually starting to be recognized more by popular culture at large and by the establishment. I don't know if anyone was there, but there was a fabulous example of that last month when Zappa's 200 Motels was performed at the South Bank. So it's really fabulous to see these sort of events taking place, acknowledging this, in my view, genius of popular music. A few words before I kick off, just about the format of the event. Like Isabel said, I'll start off with my presentation on Zappa and Virtuality. And I'll then hand over to Richard Hand, my colleague here, who will then talk about the satirical discourse of Zappa. And then after that, we'll move on to Richard Hemmings or Evil Dick. I'll let you decide, Richard, what you want to call yourself. He's going to discuss the importance of unpredictability in Zappa's music. And if anyone's seen the installation upstairs, it's quite apparent that that is a really cogent aspect of both the installation and, of course, of Zappa's music as well. And once we've done the three brief presentations, lasting about 20 minutes each, we'll then open the floor up. In my own case, I'm going to deliberately stay away from discussing the resonance with Farmer's installation. I'm hopefully going to plant some ideas in everyone's minds, and then when we open up the discussion a little bit later on, we can perhaps explore them a little bit further. So just before I begin the presentation, I thought it may be useful for those of you who are coming more from the sort of sculpture side of things than the music side of things, just to explain who Frank Zappa is. I presume, you know, everyone does know who he is, but just a quick whistle stop, sort of 30-second tour of who Zappa is, and I suppose why I personally got involved and interested in his music, really. He was born in December 1940, the same month, same year as John Lennon. And I suppose one of most people who are aware of Zappa probably think of him a bit like this. This is certainly the image that I associated with Zappa as I was a young child growing up. And you get these sort of iconic images of Zappa, the great guitarist, and the sort of rock god, if you like. So these are very commonplace images that you get with Zappa. But it begins to get interesting, from my perspective anyway, when you start to see images like this, where you suddenly start to see Zappa, okay, he's still the rock musician, but this time he's conducting his band. And what you start to get here is this juxtaposition of high and low culture, which Zappa was a real expert at. I'll explore that a little bit further in the paper. He called this process conduction, and his band would all be required to respond to a range of hand signals that you know, could be more traditional types of conducting, or for example, he would pull on his make-believe dreadlocks and the band would have to launch into a reggae feel, for example. So he had these quite eccentric ways of working with conducting. And of course, Zappa, well before he formed the Mothers of Invention in the late 50s, had already worked with an orchestra. A lot of people aren't aware of this. They associate him solely with rock music, but he was actually writing for orchestra before he formed the Mothers of Invention in 1966. And this is a scene from 200 Motels, where he's working with the London Symphony Orchestra. And of course, Zappa didn't only work with a recording studio, but he was also fabulous. If anyone's seen any of his scores, they're beautifully handwritten scores. And there's so few rock musicians who get involved in that process. And this was a famous saying that Zappa adopted from Edgar Varèse. The present-day composer refuses to die. He very much considered himself a composer. So I'll just launch into the paper now, which lasts, as I say, around about 20 minutes, and then I'll hand over to Richard, and we'll explore some of the themes, hopefully, a little bit later on. Composer, guitarist, filmmaker, satirist, and political activist. Of all the prominent rock musicians to emerge during the mid-1960s, Frank Zappa is arguably the most complex and prolific. During his 27 years in the public eye between 1966 and 1993, Zappa released over 60 official albums between the inaugural Mothers of Invention recording Freak Out and Civilization Phase 3. A figure that does not include numerous bootleg recordings or the official posthumous releases made available by the Zappa Family Trust, and they're growing year by year. This inexhaustible creativity is complemented by unusual eclecticism, with Zappa being one of the few rock musicians to interface with both high and low culture on a regular basis, a process in which he freely juxtapositioned otherwise disparate music styles. So for example, doo-wop could go against reggae, against music concrète, against rock music, so on and so forth. And this quite often took place within the same compositions and albums. Besides a tendency for implementing this artistic freedom via his much-quoted maxim, anything, anytime, anywhere, for no reason at all, Zappa also progressively cross-referenced his own, other composers' music, and popular culture at large throughout his career. For example, his second album, Absolutely Free Alone, has allusions to Louie Louie, Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring, and Petrushka, and of course The Soldier's Tale as well. Tracks such as The Duke of Earl, Baby Love, The Planet Suite by Holst, Irving Berlin's God Bless America, and White Christmas. And all of these references simultaneously depict numerous references for his listeners. Zappa appeared to have a clear belief in the semiological power of music, describing the process in his autobiography as archetypal American musical icons, incorporating them to put what he described, and I quote, a spin on any lyric in their vicinity. Regarding the intended impartation of meaning, he stated, and I quote, the audience doesn't have to know, for example, who Jan Garber or Lester Lannan is to appreciate these textures. The average guy is not going to say, hey, Richie, check this out, they're doing Lester. He knows what the style means. He's groaned over it in old movies on Channel 13 for years. This comment not only resonates with Zappa's acute awareness of his audience's musical knowledge, which he tended to use as a semiotic horizon to not only signify, but to resignify musical materials. As I indicated in a recent essay for Contemporary Theatre Review last year, Zappa would often accentuate the high entertainment of otherwise serious pieces by superimposing frivolity over the original text, resulting in compositions such as Also Sprach Zarathustra becoming detached from their original meaning. And I did see that a lot upstairs when I was walking around, sort of a musical bricolage. In addition to attacking the seriousness of high art, Zappa is quoted as regarding the introduction of Stravinsky into his early work is what he describes as a get-acquainted offer, seemingly using these gestures as tasters for the more avant-garde experiments he was to introduce later in his career. It's important at this point to point out that musical references to Zappa's own work are also very prevalent throughout his career, with even his final album, Civilization Phase 3, merging fragments from albums such as Thingfish, The Perfect Stranger, and also Lumpy Gravy. Although this practice could be regarded as self-plagiarizing, Zappa considered it is similar to the re-emergence of characters in novels. He commented, and I quote from his autobiography, when a novelist invents a character, if the character is a good one, he takes on a life of his own, why should he get to go to only one party, end quote. Although this overt cross-referencing process could be sarcastically regarded as a means of manipulating the music business, facilitating what Ben Watson describes as a neurotic response to mass culture, the transformation of consumer into collector, it also has the impact of making the intended meaning and classification of Zappa's work unusually problematic. For example, albums such as the London Symphony Orchestra Volume 1 and Hot Rats are classified by rock and pop by the All Music Guide, despite the fact that they're essentially classical and jazz albums. Additionally, depending on where one accesses Zappa's music chronologically, this constant reoccurrence of musical and cultural material has the potential of instigating a psychological Russian doll effect on the listener, often prompting the close examination of not only his musical influences in past and future catalogue, but also the extra musical meanings that he's referring to. Regarding Zappa's personal conceptual positioning of music, he was clear that all of his creative output was unified by a philosophy that he entitled The Big Note. In a 1968 article that he wrote for Life magazine, he stated the following: "Everything in the universe is composed basically of vibrations. Light is a vibration, sound is a vibration, atoms are composed of vibrations. And all of these vibrations just might be harmonics of some incomprehensible fundamental cosmic tone." As outlined by DeVille and Norris, the big note concept resonates strongly with discoveries of Nobel Prize winners Robert Wilson and Onzo Penzias, who discovered in 1965, 3 years before the Zappa interview that I just quoted, that a residual sound related to the Big Bang was still apparent in the universe, and that this sound was judged to be vibrating at approximately 4,080 megahertz, slightly flatter than B in equal temperament tuning. Zappa's Big Note also has some resonance with Pythagoras' belief that music serves as a reflection of the inherent sounds produced by the solar system, a philosophy continued by Plato in the Myth of Ur, for example, where he envisaged the resonance inherent in the orbit of the earthly planets to constitute a single harmonious scale. I'm not suggesting that Zappa's music incorporated a mystical Pythagorean or even Platonic dimension, where the results of his creativity would be regarded as a metaphysical representation of the eternal. However, his practice of developing individual compositions over many years does resonate with a musical pendurantist perspective, where musical works are seen to exist atemporally, obtaining their ontological status from a fusion of performances, with individual performances being regarded as temporal parts of an ongoing musical work. Regardless of whether Zappa was aware of these philosophical positions or not, it's apparent that not only his compositions, but his entire creative output is littered with a web of fractal logic, where consistent patterns are apparent between single tracks, entire albums, public performances, in addition to non-musical materials such as press interviews and also cover art. The cover of Overnight Sensation presents an indicative example of what I'm talking about. And this can be regarded as a painting inside of a painting, which is itself a painting of a mirror. The reflection in the mirror is of a hotel room, which graphically depicts Zappa's perception of the life of a touring musician, with indexical signifiers such as underwear, band publicity, suitcases, flight tickets, combined with more subliminal phallic symbols, such as a penis-like fire hydrant or a vagina-shaped grapefruit and a semen-dripping water hose. It's proposed that this direct and subliminal attention to explicit content in particular has the capacity to facilitate his audience to ask who is actually looking in the mirror, almost in a Kierkegaardian sense, in terms of encouraging readers to question truth. Zappa, like Kierkegaard, also used aliases in his writing. This begs the question, does this meaning relate exclusively to Zappa and his band members? Or, as outlined in a 1973 Go Setter article, is Zappa, and I quote, "the distorted mirror through which we experience ourselves in the neurotic, perverted society that man has created," End quote. As discussed in selected essays in the Frank Zappa and the And collection, this dialogic balance between the meaning of Zappa's work being extraneous or personal in nature is one of the principal factors that make his work so appealing. In addition to the big note, Zappa's consideration of his individual compositions and recordings being part of a unified whole were negotiated principally by two other self-titled philosophies, Project Object and Xenochrony. Time manipulation techniques which Zappa often used to indoctrinate a variety of overt and subliminal semiological clues into his compositions, in addition to providing rationales for his reuse of existing material and rearrangements of compositions, as I've just outlined earlier. As I've stated in other essays, Zappa's persistent reuse of his own and other composers' material suggests that he differentiated between the completed work of art and the ongoing challenge of redefining it. This process is not only similar to the notion of how literary texts are constantly in a state of change as they age, take Shakespeare for example, but also what many of you may have heard described in mainstream philosophy as types, what Zappa would describe as the object and their more derivative tokens. And I've heard this described in other circles as the difference between the text and the work. It's all talking about the same thing, the difference between the small part and the whole. The other important technique that Zappa incorporated into his creative process was that of xenochrony, meaning alien time. This was principally used to synchronically fuse two otherwise incongruent individual textual strands into a single performance. Unlike traditional overdubbing, which focuses on multiple takes being intentionally part of the same composition, xenochrony incorporates not only takes from incongruent live performances or studio takes, but also features takes from incongruent compositions. So any interactions that take place between the performers actually has no intentionality on the part of the player, purely taking place in a virtual dimension. This is interesting because it's very different. It's an interesting distinction to John Cage's work, for example, who aimed principally to eliminate the intentionality and also the hierarchical dominance of the composer, not the performer. And this obviously would not have been something that Zappa would have adhered to because he really believed that the composer was king. In Zappa's case, although chance operation took place at the level of how the xenochronic parts combined, it could be argued that his godlike manipulation of recorded musical content was reflexive of his traditional westernized notions of the composer-performer relationship. As he stated, and I quote, "Music comes from composers, not musicians." Zappa used these techniques to allude not only to numerous semiological references of his own and other composers' music, band folklore and popular culture at large, but also to construct what Paul Sandon describes as virtual liveness, where the detail of what actually constructs a live performance requires consideration and clarification. Zappa's 1991 release, The Best Band You Never Heard in Your Life, serves as an indicative example of virtual live performance. With the album being presented as a unified concert performance, but in reality being compiled from numerous locations from the 1988 tour, which were cut and pasted together. Indeed, the virtual dimension of this album is made even more complex due to the use of guitar solos being imported xenochronically, i.e. from a different concert again. So both the musicians and the guitar solos all came from different times and places. This process was taken a stage further on the six-part You Can't Do That on Stage Anymore, which featured cut-and-paste techniques that facilitated Zappa alumni performing together for the first time, when in reality they actually played together decades apart. For example, the version of Montana on You Can't Do That on Stage Anymore, Volume 4, includes a fusion of a 1973 live recording from the Roxy Theatre in Los Angeles with a recording taken 11 years later, which was recorded in Hollywood. And unsurprisingly, Zappa is the only constant between the two time frames. And this is the case on many recordings on the six-part series. Zappa seems to be the only constant. The musicians can change, but Zappa, the composer, is a constant. And this goes some way to verifying his belief that musicians were secondary to the compositions themselves. And of course, the composer, as I said before, was king. So in conclusion, philosopher Paul Weiss proposes that any event, such as the development of a mountain range, the growth of a flower, or indeed a musical composition, whatever the length of its ongoing redevelopment, is ultimately one single present, not a sequence of presence as we experience it. Weiss describes it impossible to grasp the full nature of the single present because of the impossibility of experiencing all of its instances. Likewise, with many of Zappa's compositions that have been rearranged and recomposed over many years in multiple times and multiple places, we cannot experience them as a single entity, but via snapshots of smaller events which let us consider or indeed measure the larger whole. Interestingly, this process is similar not only to the theory of perdurantism, which is a big word I mentioned before, but also to a musical theory called organicism, where a musical work is conceptualized as an organism, where individual parts combine to form part of a functioning whole, with the human body acting as a sort of a metaphor for the musical work. The concept has the roots in the work of philosopher George Hegel, who stated that, and I quote, "If the work is a genuine work of art, the more exact the detail, the greater the unity of the whole," end quote. Using the philosophies outlined in this short presentation, our experience of Zappa's music, regardless of our method of analysis, is virtual by default, as we are only ever experiencing but a single occurrence of the ontological whole, which is constantly in a case of becoming, something Zappa deliberately incorporated into his creative process. Metaphorically, his music is in some ways analogous to a pioneering building, which contrasts sharply with its environment, which we could say in Zappa's case is the music industry, awaiting surrounding structures. In Zappa's case, that would be other artists and audiences to catch up, effectively acting as an inspirational exemplar for others to follow. Taking the architecture metaphor a step further, just as the outside of buildings create hermeneutic expectations of the inside, much of the imagery and visual gestures of popular music prepares the listener or the fan with expectations of what is to come. However, this is often not the case for Zappa, whose album covers and rock star persona in particular contrast strongly with the variety and stylistic incongruence of his music. In his autobiography, Zappa made a comparison of moving mobiles and sound sculptures to composing music, an analogy that can be extended. Just as a sculptor stands back from his work to examine it from various angles to ensure that it not only works as a whole, but has various meanings depending on the perspectives one views it from, so Zappa, with his manipulation of space, time, and place, facilitates the listener to experience music without the constraints, expectations, and impacts of image, style, and genre, making the virtuality of his music all the more profound. Most importantly, although a sculpture can be appreciated from multiple angles, the artist often positions it within a space where the most pertinent view is initially seen by all. This is something that was carefully manipulated by Zappa. He used rock music as a centripetal pull, of which numerous other styles and genres were subtly and often subliminally introduced to his listeners. If one of the objectives of art is to make impossible or imperceptible things appear real, then some of Zappa's work fulfills this objective. In his autobiography, he discusses placing the work into a virtual frame, believing that without this humble appliance, that's Zappa's terminology, you can't know where the art stops and the real world begins. He continues to assert that, and I quote, anything can be music, but it doesn't become music until someone wills it to be music, and the audience listening to it decides to perceive it as music, end quote. Following in these footsteps of artists such as Marcel Duchamp or John Cage, is this a space where reality, as we experience it, has the potential to be suspended and a virtual space begin? To quote Marshall Cosburn, music represents itself and presents itself at the junction between the here and the there, the threshold where one shreds the mastery of the eye, end quote. I would propose that this represents Zappa's idiolect, and I would arguably say Geoffrey Farmer's too. It represents both of the idiolects perfectly. Thanks very much. Thank you. As I say, I won't discuss anything about Farmer. I'll hand over to my colleague, Professor Richard Hahn now. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot, Paul. I'm going to pick up on some of those themes. It's actually quite helpful. Great. In looking at Zappa, we're tempted to coin a word such as enigmatist. His oeuvre offers a diverse range of styles from jazz and the music concrète and the classical, whatever that may be, to the deliberate pastiche of pop styles. He could be nihilistic, arguing that, to quote him, the basic building block of the universe is not hydrogen, but stupidity, and expecting to be forgotten towards the end of his life. He can be seen as an example of the aesthetic of the absurd. He did regard himself on occasion as a latter-day Dadaist, but he can also be a highly articulate and outspoken political and satirical critic. This can be targeting organized religion, as in the song Dumb All Over, and I'll just quote some of the lyrics there. You can't run a country by a book of religion, not by a heap or a lump or a smidgen of foolish rules of ancient date designed to make you all feel great while you fold, spindle and mutilate those unbelievers from another state. To arms, hooray, that's great. Two legs ain't bad, unless there's a crate they ship the parts to mama in. The powerful and lucidly acerbic critique contained in these lyrics is reminiscent of satirical verse going back to figures like Lord Byron, who said lines like, you know, let there be light, said God, and there was light. Let there be blood, said man, and there's a sea. In the 80s, and as far as he lived into the 90s, Zappa became more directly politicised, finding Ronald Reagan and that breed of republicanism and neoconservatism particularly abhorrent. Famously, Zappa even considered standing for president himself. He would have stood a cat's in hell chance of being elected, of course, but his political aspirations did find some outlet in the fact that Zappa was a close friend of the Czechoslovakian president Václav Havel, acting as the country's trade, tourism and cultural liaison to the West for several months until he was vetoed by James Baker, the Republican Secretary of State. Zappa's most sustained satirical visions are probably his two epic sagas, Joe's Garage and Thingfish. The works are both visceral and sexual, yet complex and thought-provoking, angrily provocative, yet consistently amusing, fragmented and absurd, yet with a coherence and integrity to their satirical vision. The tone is scathing, and yet both are profoundly impassioned. They are misanthropic and misogynistic, and yet libertarian and radical. Both works are unequivocally sexualized satires. In Joe's Garage, Zappa lambasts the world of groupies and presents a 1984-esque dystopia in which its central character, Joe, is imprisoned for pluking a sex machine manufactured by the First Church of Appliantology to death. In Thingfish, in part a conspiracy-infused account of the rise of AIDS, Zappa charts the adventure of two uptight yuppies who've walked into the wrong Broadway show and explode into sexual excesses which question their own lives and the very system they live in. Both works are sustained visions, reminiscent of satirical cycles such as William Hogarth's Harlot's Progress and the Rake's Progress in the early 18th century. Thingfish is also an exploration of the rock musical genre, a rocky horror show which pushes the satire of sexuality even further. In his consistent attention to sexual satire, Zappa often seems to be in the tradition of the 17th century Earl of Rochester, the 19th century Octave Mirbeau, or Zappa's contemporary and compatriot Robert Crumb. These satirists brutally use the taboos of the obscene and the scatological in order to eviscerate what they regard as the hypocrisies of the contemporary world. These and other satirists like Zappa show us ugliness. They make the world ugly in order to force us to see the truth. Ugly is more than just an adjective for Zappa. It is a state of being and a critical weapon. As Michelle Delville and Andrew Norris claim, ugliness becomes an ideological tool against both aesthetic and political kitsch. It's tempting to extend the parallel with Zappa and other sexual satirists such as the Marquis de Sade and Georges Bataille, but probably Rochester, Mirbeau, Crumb and Zappa share a quality of hilarity, albeit sometimes underpinned with despair and horror. There is a devastating critique, but they can laugh wildly as they expose the world's ugliness. At times, Philip Brophy's film studies term of horrorality, which combining horror and hilarity, seems curiously apt in Zappa, and I'll come back to look at that in a more sustained way in a moment. Of course, Zappa's not just a creator of epic narrative sagas, no more than he's just a lyricist. What we find in Zappa is the integration of art. The eclecticism of Zappa and his audacious span of styles and mixture of modes is admirably echoed in Geoffrey Farmer's extraordinary Let's Make the Water Turn Black installation upstairs. Zappa is also inherently playful, a quality that enforces the postmodern dimension to his achievement. Like someone like Eric Satie, a parallel convincingly explored by Kevin Currier in Dangerous Kitchen, Zappa has great wit and an unproblematic interest in spanning so-called high and popular culture. In Zappa's case, there's a particular interest in popular horror and science fiction culture and the use of horror for satirical ends. When looking at the link between horror and popular music, we might think of Bobby Boris Pickett's novelty song The Monster Mash, or the appropriated horror iconography prevalent in heavy metal, or the specific images constructed by Kiss or Rob Zombie. One of the preeminent horror music icons in popular culture is Alice, who was discovered by Frank Zappa, his first three albums being recorded on Zappa's Bizarre label. Zappa may seem a surprising associate with horror, after those other ones we've just mentioned, and yet it is a profound relationship. Throughout his career, Zappa reveals a recurrent interest in popular horror culture, which is manifest in his achievements as a creative force of performance, composition, and production. Zappa was very much a live performer, who for much of his career thrived on touring and created major albums, as we've just heard, out of utilising various recordings of these live shows. One particular category of concert that seemed to have a special place for him were the Halloween concerts. At its heart, Halloween has a Saturnalian function. In principle, the modern Halloween is a carnivalesque celebration in a Bakhtinian sense, perceived authority in the social hierarchy that keeps society in order, subverted and even profaned through playful disorder and hilarity. The rational world of everyday life is challenged by the iconography of the supernatural, horror, the grotesque, and the taboo, and by feasting, merrymaking, and costuming, and of course pumpkins, which are recurrent, not least in the installation upstairs, but throughout Zappa's work. The energies of the suppressed voices in society and within ourselves can be given legitimised expression. In the case of Zappa, the Halloween concerts provided an especially compelling context for Saturnalian activity, with a context that emphasises the carnivalesque dynamics of performance, music and audience. Something I do in my chapter for Paul's book is chart Zappa's Halloween shows. And one of the most valuable artefacts we have is the documentation in the Baby Snakes video and the Dub Room special films, which show us, have footage from the Halloween concerts within them. On the album You Can't Do That on Stage Anymore, Volume 6, there's a short track which is just called New York City Halloween Audience. The sound of this track, the music, if you will, is the wild audience recorded at the New York Palladium on Halloween 1981. The audience has become a title in its own right, the uproarious melody of the Saturnalian crowd waiting for the concert to begin is a song in its own right. Zappa's most direct song about Halloween is the reggae-based Goblin Girl. This portrait song describes a young woman from Da Mystery World who's costumed as a black and green goblin for a Halloween party. The song is essentially a prolonged double entendre, punning on goblin and gobbling, although a song about oral sex, which seems to objectify women, may be offensive to some. It can also be seen as a celebratory song, celebrating sex disguise and the transformative and fetishistic potential of masquerade. If Goblin Girls focuses on a female being, Zombie Woof is a male monster. While Goblin Girl is beautiful and obliging, the masculine Zombie Woof is a far more menacing figure. The narrative is subjective, conveyed in first person quite significantly. The narrator tries to sleep on an antique bed made some 300 years ago, but like the fateful beds in the gothic tales of Wilkie Collins or M.R. James, the experience is far from rejuvenating. The bed metamorphoses the narrator into part zombie, but also woof, a lycanthropic werewolf. The account of the monster paints a picture of distortion with one huge fang and an oversized foot. The reference to the deformed foot is an autobiographical moment on Zappa's part in the 1971 Rainbow Theatre assault. He was attacked in London. He had seriously broke his leg and it distorted his feet. And he also refers to this in Dancing Fool, probably his most successful song in terms of the charts. Zappa is therefore the monster. After all, and this is picked up interestingly by Delville and Norris, who contest that, talking in general terms, that Zappa is a monster, a producer of shocking generic mixes and a transgressor of permitted aspiration, whose addiction to pure research is also a program of ceaseless self-recreation, recreation. By implication, Zappa's monstrosity lies in his potent and profound commitment to self-adaptation and hybridization. And it's interesting how he engages in autobiographical mirroring, not least when he makes himself the transforming and distorted monster that is the Zombie Woof. You know, this incredible eclecticism of the man is something monstrous, and he's acknowledging it in this short song. The most significant motif within the narrative of Zombie Woof, however, is sexual violence. The monster self is, to quote, as evil as you could be, a predatory figure of sexual menace who kidnaps dormitory ladies. The song celebrates popular horror culture and its melodramatic traditions of damsels in distress and monstrous villains. To emphasize this, and horror as a form of melodrama, in some performances of the song, Zappa uses mysterioso pizzicato. Da, 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 da. And this musical cliche, it's also known as the villain's theme, is synonymous with early cinema, cartoons, pantomime and melodrama. Mysterioso pizzicato is an example of what Paul's already mentioned, an archetypal American musical icon, a recurrent technique in Zappa's oeuvre, whereby well-known tunes are incorporated into his compositions. Writing on the technique, Zappa states, "I can put sounds together that tell more than the story in the lyrics, especially to American listeners who are raised on these subliminal clichés, shaping their audio reality from the cradle to the elevator." Other examples in Zappa's work include the use of the theme tune from the popular TV series The Twilight Zone, composed by Marius Constant. That's something I was struck with in the second room of the installation upstairs, a surrealistic landscape, rather like the opening montage of The Twilight Zone, not of sight, not of sound, but of mind and all of that, the fragmented, iconic images. The familiar Twilight Zone theme instantly creates a sense of the weird and uncanny. Zappa uses it in numerous songs, including live versions of Pygmy Twilight, Tinseltown Rebellion, and Jesus Thinks You're a Jerk. He frequently incorporated it into live performances of Honey, Don't You Want a Man Like Me, which is a sustained sexual satire. It's a narrative song describing a mundane yet fraught adult encounter. A couple meet at a singles bar, and following dancing and flirtation and dinner, they end up at her home. If this follows the cliched pattern of a one-night stand, the male character will be disappointed because we're told she does not kiss him. It's at this point in several performances that the Twilight Zone theme comes in. The man is furious at the refusal of, to quote, the lousy bitch. In some versions, the Twilight Zone theme continues into the next verse where we hear the man describes in this misogynistic hate the woman as, to quote, a slut, pig, whore, bitch, and a cunt, close quote. In some live versions, Zappa replaces that final word with the word Republican, and she leaves in a petulant frenzy. The Twilight Zone theme indicates how the formulaic one-night stand culminating in direct sexual encounter, the expected pornographic cliché, has gone awry and has become uncanny and unreal. This politicisation to the tune of the Twilight Zone theme occurs in Rhyming Man, one of Zappa's most overtly political songs, which is simultaneously one of his most complex musical icon compositions. And it's a very short, only like 2.5 minutes or something, but there's at least 12 icons in this one short song. It just jumps back and forth. Rhyming Man is Zappa's uncompromising critique of the US Democrat politician Jesse Jackson. Zappa, in using musical icons so ruthlessly, is perhaps making a statement about the shallow clichés and opportunism of mainstream politics. Specifically, in using the Twilight Zone theme, Zappa endeavours to construct a mood of alienation, distrust and peril to underscore his discussion of contemporary politicians and America's future. In Zappa's cavalcade of monsters, alongside goblin girls, zombie wolves, and unscrupulous politicians, there are also examples of more epic visions. I've already mentioned Joe's Garage and Thingfish, but these also include an interest in the truly gargantuan creatures from monster movies. For example, Zappa's composition King Kong is one of his key works, and by the time it appears on the Uncle Meat album, it's become a work as gigantic as the monster it's a tribute to. I noticed in the installation upstairs, there's a broken monster head biting the camera tripod, which is a very sort of apt kind of recognition of this aspect of Zappa's work. Zappa's widow, Gail, states that, to quote her, Zappa was a fan of the fabulously cheesy and utterly cheap, and he loved the spongy meteoroids and zippered monster suits, and even the zippered and spongoid dialogue and plot lines, and of course, in some cases, the fantastic musical themes. According to Gale, his favourite movie of all time was The Brainiac, a 1962 Mexican B-movie science fiction film about a brain-eating monster, which is simultaneously from outer space and the 17th century, to work that one out. Apparently, Zappa had a real fondness for its arch pseudo-gothic soundtrack, this great composer admiring the clichés of the music as much as the clichéd narrative. Zappa seems to find a regenerative force to celebrate in cheap monster movies, the power of costume, of transformation, once again, that is not to be taken too seriously, but is all the more liberating for that. The same spirit of the carnival grotesque used his Halloween gigs. The ultimate example of this is the song Cheapness, an epic song celebrating spongoid movies and the experience of moviegoing. Again, that important sense of a collective audience. It's one of Zappa's single song masterpieces. The opening lyrics are about the audience consuming the quintessential movie theatre food, a hot dog, and then watching a Hollywood film, thus place spectator at the forefront of the event. Zappa's fantasy movie begins, and so does the spongoid deconstruction, which focuses on ill-fitting costumes, the zipper from the Black Lagoon he talks about, stereotypical characterization, strings that operate monsters, and rocks made of cardboard. All these inadequacies are most appositely summed up in the phrase, as I've just quoted, actually, the zipper from the Black Lagoon, that kind of encapsulates that tribute there, which is an allusion to one of the most paradigmatic titles of the B-movie era. Zappa develops the story of his virtual paradigmatic movie in which Frunobulax, the gargantuan poodle, runs amok destroying bonsai trees on a dry wobble landscape with its great big slimy thing, whatever that is, we're not sure. Zappa's single song masterpieces, but it was in fact originally featured in Zappa's 1972 science fiction musical Hunch and Toot. Although this project never saw the light of day, Zappa had a very clear vision for the production, with a quasi-scientific narrator, papier-mâché props and effects, science fiction paradigms and surrealistic playfulness. Zappa envisions that the giant alien's penis is a fur-covered slinky which sproings repeatedly onto the stage. If the musical play had been realised, audiences would have witnessed the bizarre satirical scene of Colonel Gaddafi pumping up a poodle-faced mutant cocktail waitress with concrete from a hose between his legs until the monstrous poodle falls down and squashes its creator. As the song Cheapness draws to a close, the lyrics locate the heart of pleasure in watching cheap horror movies, which is the experience, as he says, of laughing till you're on your knees. And if it doesn't happen to us, the song states we are to be pitied. What this reveals is how Zappa adores monster movies, but it is not for a fear effect, but for the liberating power of laughter. At the same time, it's important to acknowledge that Cheapness is not simply about laughable movies, and neither is it a nostalgia trip celebrating a safe, quaint, and outmoded cultural form of the past. In the story of this imagined film, the authorities state they may have to resort to nuclear force to stop Frunabulax. Nuclear technology is ubiquitous in 50s B-movies, both as the creator and destroyer of monstrosity. However, the National Guard also consider using napalm, the weapon synonymous with US military action during the contemporaneous Vietnam War. Buried into Zappa's world of hilarity and disillusion is the horror of contemporaneous warfare and the alienating context of contemporary politics. It could be argued that Zappa is placing a core of authentic horror into the absurd world of cheapness, a real horror peeking beneath the laughable sponge, a tumour within the humour, like a worm in an apple or the human psyche's ever-present death angst. To conclude, in drawing his cultural influences from an extremely diverse range of cultural sources, Zappa brings allusion and appropriation into an eclectic system of interplay for communal celebration, socio-political statement, or outright unbridled laughter. Satire is never far away. In promoting this very event, Guitar Player magazine quoted Zappa himself, "Music is always a commentary on society." And in Zappa, as in the installation upstairs, it can be a synesthetic experience. Thank you.
Right, well, I'm the only person who hasn't bothered to write a paper, I'm afraid. So I'm going to waffle on and bumble my way through a PowerPoint presentation, which has been cobbled together, hopefully, to, time with the sculpture upstairs. The title of my talk was, at one point, marketed as being Unpredictability in Zappa's Music and Why It Matters. It's kind of changed since then, and now it's Unpredictability in Zappa's Music and his use of algorithms, which sounds very exciting. But there are two words there which I think do relate, sort of, to the sculpture upstairs, the first one being unpredictability. I'm assuming most of you have been up there and walked around it. If not, then this might actually prepare you, I suppose. And the other word is algorithm, which I'll explain if you don't know what that is. An algorithm, well, I'm not going to explain it now, actually, but the sculpture itself is sort of operated, all the sound and the light and the motion is all kind of computer operated algorithmically. So that's my plan, and let's crack on. So some definitions. What is predictable music? What is unpredictable music? And what the hell is an algorithm? My PhD, I wrote a PhD, and that was to do with unpredictable popular music. And I always found that it was impossible really to sort of talk about unpredictability in music without addressing what predictability in music was. Because I was talking about popular music, you've kind of got quite a few areas you can look at in terms of predictability. So one of the areas I looked at was the structure of pieces of music. Take, for example, a pop song. Everybody who's ever listened to a pop song will know after a while it becomes ingrained in your brain that there is a structure to a pop song. It usually follows a kind of introduction bit, and then we have a verse bit, and then probably another verse bit, and then a chorus, and then a verse bit, and a chorus, and so on. And we've had this all our lives. We kind of know what to expect structurally from a pop song. So that's an example of something that's predictable, a predictable kind of music. Just to elaborate on that further, a long while ago in the 1980s, there was a band called the KLF. Some of you may remember the KLF. They had a terrible number one hit with a song called Doctor in the TARDIS. And this was made up of samples taken from, well, I think the Doctor Who theme tune was one of them, and other bits they cobbled together and created this song, which miraculously went to number one. And off the back of this, they wrote a book, and the book is called The Manual, How to Have a Number One the Easy Way, or something like that. And in it, they set out a series of steps which you have to follow, because if you don't follow them, you won't go to number one. One of the most important things you have to be is unemployed. And once you've achieved that, whenever you go to an office to have a meeting, you have to make a phone call at the office. Don't want to spend any money on phone calls. And these are all very important little details to have this number one hit that you all want. This is sort of a description of an algorithm. It's a set of instructions that has a specific outcome. And although Zappa didn't really get into this side of thing until a little bit later on in his career, it's still pertinent and it still relates to the sculpture upstairs. So I'm gonna stick with this. Okay, so unpredictability in Zappa's music. Now, some of these things have been covered a little bit today, and I'll probably try to cover them again, but I won't go into too much detail. Unpredictability in performance. So we've already had a little bit of a talk about Zappa's conduction. I'm not sure if that was his term, was it? Did he invent that term? I thought that was... doesn't matter. So conduction or conducted improvisation. There's a really good example on the Baby Snakes DVD or film, if you've seen that. There are other recorded examples on albums like Weasel's Rip My Flesh. But he had a number of physical signals which he would use to kind of like change the direction of a band in mid-flow. So a few of them would be things like holding up your hand like this to mean playing 5-4 or 5-8 play a C chord or play an A chord, do lots of random notes on the piano, play a long, wiggly sort of sound. You see him do this occasionally to try and control the brass players in some kind of, I don't know, wiggly, sort of brassy sort of sound. Other ones would be, I think you covered the dreadlocks for play reggae. And that was heavy metal. So he had a lot of them, the point is, all these cues would be used at any point in a live performance. So if you went to a concert one night and you went to see him again the next night, it would not be the same concert. Not least because he changed the running order every night as well. So the band had to be incredibly well rehearsed to keep up with all this. But that's one example of unpredictability in Zappa's music. Another one. I mean, this list is not comprehensive. It's kind of a reduced list. But we have meltdowns. This is a kind of a technique he uses. You kind of read mixed things on the internet. But in his book, he basically says that a meltdown would be when the band would kind of accompany him, his vocal, with an improvisation that is more to do with rhythm and sound effects and creating a kind of a texture rather than chords and harmonies and that sort of thing. There's an example of meltdowns on, or there are some examples of meltdowns on the album The Man from Utopia, where we have the charming song The Jazz Discharge Party Hats, which is all a song. Zappa actually ad-libbed the entire thing live on stage, and it was referring to the activities of his band members putting girls' pants on their heads during, some sort of after-show activity around a swimming pool, and the substance inside the pants. So there you go. Let's drop that one in there. So that's another one. And then there's, of course, The Dangerous Kitchen, which is an example of Zappa actually had written the words, but the band then would improvise to the words. And there are other examples as well. In a sense, it's a bit like a free improvisation. Indeterminacy. This isn't really a Zappa word. This is more of a John Cage word. It's kind of mixed in with that New York school of composers, people like John Cage, and I'm trying to remember, Morton Feldman, Christian Wolff, those sorts of guys. Indeterminacy is where there's an openness in the score's interpretation. So, for example, a John Cage composition where he had these compositions called timepieces, where events would be sort of staged in you'd have to basically follow the clock to play your piece of music. Morton Feldman had other pieces where he would state the kind of, I believe the word is tessitura of the pitch, where it's either high, medium, or low, but the pitch you played in your score, you'd actually choose the pitch yourself as a performer. He didn't specify the exact pitch. And Zappa has a piece called Approximate, which appears, trying to remember the album it's on. It's on the Helsinki album, the stage album, number 2, I think. I can't remember, probably on another one as well. But on that album, the rhythms were, or on that particular song, Approximate, the rhythms are specified, but the pitches aren't, although there is a melodic contour provided. So the performers of the piece are able to choose a kind of, or at least come up with their own pitch contour or melodic contour for the song. But it's different every time they perform it. So that's an example of indeterminacy in Zappa's music. And then we have the kind of more technology-based uses of unpredictability and the studio procedures, such as music concrete. Music concrete originated, I believe, in France with the composer Pierre Schaeffer. And it's essentially sticking together bits of tape, magnetic tape with sounds on. Obviously been supersided since with the use of computers with the cut and paste kind of technology. But Zappa was doing it then with tape, bits of magnetic tape, and sticking them all together, constructing very unpredictable sounding pieces of music. And on Lumpy Gravy, you get such pieces. You know, you get sections where you might get a bit of surf music going into people talking inside a grand piano, which then cuts to people singing. Oh, there's not a lot of singing on the album, but then maybe into an orchestral section, which has been sped up. So it's a very unpredictable listening experience. Not like your verse, chorus sort of experience. And then, of course, there's the xenochronicity, or strange time, or alien time, or sometimes it's not even called xenochronicity, sometimes it's just called xenochrony, where Zappa would take recordings taken from different periods and put them together, overlay them in some way. There's a piece of music on Shake Your Booty called Rubber Shirt, where he takes a drum recording of Terry Bozzio, the drummer, and puts the bass part of Patrick O'Hearn recorded at a completely different time over the top of that. And it makes you think that it's quite interesting how those two different tracks are overlaid, because if you just had the start point somewhere else, you'd end up with a completely different piece of music. So anyway, those are a few examples of how Zappa was able to introduce some unpredictability in his music. Moving on. Zappa algorithms. So as I said, Zappa didn't really get into the kind of algorithmic method of composing until later in his career, more in the 80s, I suppose, when he was using his trusty Synclavier computer music workstation, on which he composed albums such as Jazz from Hell and Civilization Phase 3. But it also appeared, to a lesser extent, on The Perfect Stranger, which was the album he did with Pierre Boulez, and Frank Zappa Meets the Mothers of Prevention. Those sorts of albums have a bit of Synclavier on. And he also used it live, of course, in the towards the end of the 80s, and you can hear that on the Best Bands You Never Heard in Your Life, and Jazz, what's the other one called? Jazz? No, the other 88 album, live album. Make the Jazz Noise Here, that's the one. Yeah, so there's some Synclavier on that as well. So some of the pieces I want to demonstrate today are, and this is going to require some sound, two pieces I'm going to try and get through. One of them is the piece of music called Calculus, and another is called The Girl in the Magnesium Dress. Which have unpredictable characteristics and use algorithms. Shall we move on? Here we go. Excellent. So Calculus is on the album Dance Me This. Has anybody heard Dance Me This? No, nobody's heard Dance Me This because it hasn't been released yet. And it's been queued for release for about 20 years. Maybe one day we'll get to hear it. But this track existed briefly on, well, it's actually still up on the Zappa.com website. And it has an unpredictable tempo, which speeds up and slows down. Now, the tempo is derived from the vocal of the piece, which is provided by one of the Tuvan throat singers. And I will play this for you in a minute, so you'll get to kind of hear it and appreciate this sort of tempo variation. But the algorithm involved is a little computer program written by Todd Vega, who used to work with Frank Zappa. He was his Synclavier assistant. And the little program tracks the vocal and superimposes a sort of tempo map or a tempo grid on top of it that the Synclavier can then follow. And Frank Zappa kind of composed some cheesy little bass and drum and bass kind of thing to go with it. So I'll play that now, hopefully, if I can get this to work. I don't know where the mouse has gone. Yeah, there we go. Let's see if this works. Thank you. So there you go. That was Calculus from the unreleased album Dance Me This. And I think it's quite clear when you listen to that that the tempo is not at a kind of metronomic pulse. It's moving all over the place. And the algorithmic program was used to kind of follow that little tempo there. Okay, moving on. So another example of Zappa using an algorithm in his music to create some sort of unpredictable outcome as well is the piece The Girl in the Magnesium Dress, which was first heard on the Perfect Stranger album. And in actual fact, it was also performed by the Ensemble Moderne for the Frankfurt Festival concerts as well. And it's on the album The Yellow Shark, but it sounds completely different if you listen to it on that album. If you do a sort of A, B, the two tracks, they just sound totally different. So the history behind the Girl in the Magnesium Dress is that there's a little story that goes with it. Effectively, Frank Zappa, with his synclavier, was trying to find ways of entering information into it. So with the synclavier, it had a little keyboard with it, which was a touch-sensitive keyboard. So that's obviously one way you can enter in note information into a synclavier. He also used a sort of drum pad, which he found quite useful for entering rapid passages of notes of different velocities or different loudnesses, if you like. And another way was with a guitar controller, which is like a dummy guitar, really. But today we might call it a MIDI controller, but I don't think the synclavier was MIDI. This was kind of pre-MIDI, I think. Although a similar sort of idea. If you know what MIDI is, it's a kind of a language used by digital musical equipment to kind of join it all together, so everything's talking the same language. Musical instrument digital interface is what MIDI stands for. But Zappa had this guitar controller, and he was trying to enter in some notes into the guitar, and basically it was garbage. He basically professed that his technique was too slovenly to actually make it play properly, and so none of the stuff he was trying to play on the guitar would end up in the synclavier how it was meant to end up. But Zappa, ever for being the innovator that he was, he did manage to find a kind of positive in all this, because it turns out that although he was playing, well, he wasn't playing what he wanted to play on the guitar, it was still producing a load of numerical information, which he was able, with an algorithmic program, to convert into what he called blank notes, or note blanks, which he could then compose or sort of superimpose pitch information onto. And that's what you get in the Girl in the Magnesium Dress. It's this kind of numerical data which is converted into rhythm, really. And then Zappa then composed some sort of pitches for that. I think, have we got enough time to hear a bit of that as well? I don't know how fast I'm going here, really. So here it is, Girl with Magnesium Dress. Oops. I won't play the whole thing, I'll just play a bit. You think about it, it's an awful lot of pitches you've got to come up with because the notes are moving so quickly. This is a very early synclavier piece, really, sort of recorded at the time when digital samples hadn't really kicked in a big way. So these were all really, I think these are probably the sounds that came with the synclavier and are probably quite basic and rather nasty sounding sounds, really. So, did any of that make any sense? Really, what we've done so far is talked about unpredictability in Zappa's music and its use of algorithms. And I kind of want to try and tie that in a little bit with Geoffrey Farmer's sculpture. My own initial reaction to it was, what's this got to do with Frank Zappa? Because visually, I didn't get the connection between the sculptures, the physical sculptures, and Frank Zappa. So it was obviously, there was obviously something else going on here, and I had to do a bit of research. I won't go into it in a great deal of detail, but here's a few points which might be worth mentioning. So the key features, or some of the key features, there's probably a lot of key features, I'm not an expert on this piece, but one of them is the unpredictability, in the sense that the movement, the lighting, and the music are controlled algorithmically and sometimes randomly. There are set pieces in the sculpture, so there are pieces which are very deliberate, and all the sound and the movement and the lighting are all kind of pre-programmed, prepared for you, if you like. But there are other moments where everything is left to randomness or a kind of random algorithm, if you like. This reminded me a little bit about Zappa's kind of conducting methods or his kind of conducted improvisation, because there were often cues that he would give which would trigger a pre-rehearsed section within the improvisation. So amongst all the kind of improv that was going on and all the kind of hand signals he was giving to make people improvise a certain way, there are other moments where they would actually be playing something that had been pre-rehearsed. So a kind of similarity there. A little bit about the sound itself that accompanies the sculpture. I only learnt this tonight, but apparently the sound archive or sound library is, how long was it again? 90 hours? 60 hours long. So we've got 60 hours worth of sound that can be randomly selected from. So the chance of you ever experiencing the same combination of sound is quite unlikely. Combine that with the movement and the lighting, then you end up having a piece which is very much almost living. It's my understanding that Geoffrey Farmer hopes in the future to make this much more like a musical instrument. He's hoping that he can improvise with it, and that the algorithmic side of things starts to evolve more, so it becomes a lot more organic. Zappa, I don't think, ever managed to get to that point, although there's, if he'd carried on living for a bit longer, who knows what he'd been up to by now. He'd probably be, I don't know, some kind of president or something. but anyway, so a few more things about the sculpture, or about Geoffrey Farmer's own influences. John Cage, very big influence. William Burroughs' cut-up techniques, also an influence. So these sorts of ideas are feeding in. It's not just about Zappa. I think there's a lot of Geoffrey Farmer in this piece too. It's almost quite a personal piece. It's a homage to Frank Zappa, but I think it's also, it's very personal, which is why when you look at it, you don't necessarily get Frank Zappa screaming at you. There's actually something else there too. So I think I'm going to wrap it up there just to stop myself from talking anymore. Okay, thank you very much.
Fine then.
Yeah.
Well, thank you all very much for being here and for your contributions. I'm just going to ask a couple of questions, I guess, to warm us up, like I said before. But before saying that, I was also thinking about the way in which or how much Geoffrey Farmer has actually said about whether or not the piece is about Zappa or a homage to Zappa. Because if I recall rightly, what he does say is it's not about Zappa, but it's more like using Zappa as a means of saying something else. And that said and that accepted, I still felt that the more I kind of looked at the piece and understood, particularly I suppose about Zappa's ideas about structure or time or unpredictability, the more I thought, well, it's about Zappa, or it's informed by Zappa in quite specific ways, but also I think as Richard Hemmings said, it's very deeply personal and it's very much Geoffrey Farmer work and it connects kind of to Jess's work. But I was just wondering that perhaps the two of you, Paul and Richard Hand, I'm confused by the two Richards at the table, because I know you saw it, you came a bit early today and you just sort of went straight in there. Was your reaction, what does this have to do with Zappa, or were you very much turning it into something that was about Zappa?
Well, for my part, I found I was picking up on certain iconic images, but also that personal vision. I mean, that was such a Zappa technique itself. I mean, he almost obsessively recorded not just his music, but his own life. I mean, and you know, mentioning in Lumpy Gravy, the people, the conversations and the piano and things like that, and sort of fanatically recording things, and almost kind of an anthropological approach almost, wasn't it? Just harvesting sounds. And so I think that ties in with that. But I certainly picked out certain images, like penguins and pumpkins and these things that are, you know, recurrent icons within his oeuvre, really. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, same here, really. I think you, like Richard said, I think when you first observe, it was the sound that hit me, actually, first. Mm-hmm. This incredible soundtrack, which goes with the installation. And then little sort of bite-sized chunks of Zappa sort of jump out at you. For example, he was brought up in the desert, so there's a lot of cacti there, I presume, mm-hmm. linking into that. And as Richard said, you know, there's pumpkins there, which he wrote a number of songs which dealt with that subject matter. For me, though, it was more to do with the conception. Mm-hmm. The fact that, like I mentioned, this Zappa's philosophy of this idea of the big note and this idea that a work is never finished. And whenever you experience Zappa's music, he loved the idea of it being different every time. And I really got a sense of that in this installation where, like Richard said, it would be very difficult to have the same experience twice because just on the chances of the lights, the installation, the music matching up would be virtually impossible. And also, from what I gather, every time Farmer puts the installation in a new premises, there's a new score. It's a new definition, I think, of the work. So I think philosophically, it's obviously linked in with Zappa in a big way.
And I think it's possible also that it's a work that might never get finished.
Yeah.
And so I, in that sense, the sort of project-object relationship was something that seemed that was the thing that first made sense to me, I think. And I was just thinking of other connections that kind of popped into my head as you were talking, and we don't have to focus exclusively on this.
Just one thing, I mean, it's interesting, please, the actual title, of course, alludes to one of Zappa's songs, which is about his own childhood, isn't it, that one? you know, about his schoolmates, and, yep. You know, very much a reminiscing song about very early formative years. So it's probably quite significant of all the things he could have called it to draw on something that is about beginnings and childhood memories, mm-hmm. and childish pranks as well, hence the title.
And the Burroughs link, you know, the musique concrète, mm-hmm. was obviously a huge influence on Zappa, and the soundtrack, you know, it could quite easily have been a Zappa piece, just a very long one. But I'm sure you would have enjoyed the idea of, you know, 60 hours of musique concrète. It's, It's a bit like, although I only spent about an hour in there, I can imagine it would be a bit like going to watch a really long opera where you've got to spend...
Wagner.
Yeah, you need to spend sort of half a day in there, I think, to get into the space and really sort of settle inside. And
something durational in that way.
It's a durational.
Yeah.
Durational.
And I think that, because one of the terms that Geoffrey Farmer uses to describe it is as a sculptural play. So there's absolutely that that sense that it is a piece of theatre and it's a durational piece of work, and perhaps that's how it works, because it draws you in the same way that temporal forms like music or theatre do, in that you want to kind of stay with it and see what happens. And that also kind of partly relates to the unpredictability of it. And I think then another perhaps personal analogy too is the fact that, I mean, Richard, you were talking about the fact that Zappa was able to sort of indulge in this endless research. Mm. I think there's a way in which, with both Geoffrey and his collaborators who worked on the piece, they very much kind of defended the right to do that as well, rather than just producing something efficiently in a kind of gallery context, bish bash bosh is ready. They very much have a certain commitment to the piece, which isn't exactly compatible with how things systematically work normally, and the fact that they're able to keep on changing it as it changes from venue to venue. I think there's a certain perversity to that I find quite pleasing, that also seems to kind of have a personality, a repercussion with Zappa. I mean, I guess the one thing that I don't really see as being there is the satire, is the sort of dark side. The side of Zappa that makes him a difficult person, I think, especially like beyond the music, but not women.
Yeah,
and that's a way, that's something that gets kind of skirted or avoided in using or perceiving Zappa even as a thinker or as a theorist and not as a kind of flesh and blood man.
I think that's right. I mean, you know, Zappa was a hugely complicated character, and I often think with my own relationship with Zappa over the last sort of 6 or 7 years, where I've, you know, sort of, I actually only about two years with listening to nothing but Zappa. I only listened to Frank Zappa's music for about 2 years. It's not a good thing to admit, really, but I should have kept that quiet. but there are elements of his character. I think during that time you sort of really get to know the guy, and there's bits I don't like. I often make this analogy.
Which
with
bits?
how long you got? You know, I make this comparison with Wagner, for example. I love Wagner's music, but I didn't admire him as a human being. Mm. And I'm not suggesting in a million years Zappa was Wagner, but there were elements of Zappa I personally didn't like, but I love his music. You know, I really think that his music is so far ahead of its time. It's incredible. And but there were some complexities in his character.
Yeah, and also, I mean, I'm not sort of suggesting that you need to kind of that you should judge a book by an author, an artwork by its by its artist. Mm. But I suppose it's just interesting to think about how he plays with that kind of border between that satire operates via, mm. between things that are extremely kind of uncomfortable mm. or not politically correct, as mm. you might say, and what that yeah. and what that kind of means and how you take that.
Mm. Interesting, sometimes the testimony about him from former bandmen yeah. members who said what a tyrant he could be. I mean, really, you know, a bully in at times with them. But also, you know, the way it sort of embellishes something. I mean, on the Joe's Garage album, there's a song Wet T-Shirt Night, you know, which on the face of it is, you know, it's this sort of...
Have you ever been in a band?
yeah. No,
but the thing is, with being in a band, if you've ever been a band leader, you know what... bunch of pain in the ass musicians can be. So I mean I don't think being a tyrant is necessarily a bad thing if you're paying the money and or paying the members of the band, you know. Mm.
I think
it's organization.
I think it's a personal thing. I mean, you know, with Zappa, like Richard was saying, I've met quite a few of his alumni musicians, and you know, Zappa really, for example, held on to his copyright beyond the norm. In my view, you know, there's a 81-year-old keyboard player who's still having to do gigs because he's got no copyright in the recording, and things like that I'm uncomfortable with, mm. And you know, it's those sort of things. I understand the logistics of a band leader, but I think you know.
I think all of that, it's just some of these accounts where they, you know, he'd be so controlling and yet want them to play hard as well and party hard
as the band,
you know, not be dull and come back and tell him what they've been up
kind
to.
Of like, as he got older, the band got younger and kind of more complicit.
Yeah.
They were kind of more up for having a daddy.
But all I was going to say about the Wet T-Shirt Night song, because on the face of it, you know, it's a rude gag song, that it's just a rude joke. But apparently, I think it's Ruth Underwood or other musician talked about how he went to see one but walked out really upset by it, really distressed by it. And then it's incredible, he goes home and writes this thing that on the face of it is, you know, is what it is. Mm. But it was, you know, something he found distressing and offensive himself. So there's these kind of complexities. Yeah.
Thank you. I think that it would be a good moment perhaps to see if there are any questions brewing in the audience. Oh, there's one there first. Just there, Simon. And then just straight ahead here.
Having spent some time with the exhibition, occasionally, Geoffrey Farmer piece, you get the piece Sinization come on. I was aware, but I don't know or have any information on it, that Zappa, quite late on his life, recorded that. If you are familiar with that and know any more about it, could you share any information with me? Because I'd find it really quite useful. Inasmuch that I was kind of intrigued that, since it was a piece that was highly influential to him when he was really young, mm-hmm. To visit that late in life. I think he did it with the ensemble Modern, but I'm not so sure. If he did, he certainly had a lot of confidence in their abilities. But I understand also that there is a recording of it, but I don't know if that will come out. Any thoughts on that piece in relation to Zappa and where it came so late in his life?
I hold my hands up. I wasn't aware that he'd recorded it.
I think he got a. He also had one of those weird soiree things or something, I think. And Nicholas Zlolomnitsky, who actually conducted it, I think, the very first performance of Ionization, who was still alive in 1991 or two or whenever it was. Mm. I think Zappa actually tried to persuade him to conduct it as well, and I think he did. I think it was a kind of a slower, slightly slower version, because he was about 89 at the time. But so there is on the Rage and the Fury. I think is another one of these albums like Dance Me This, which is locked away in the vault, and I think it is Ferrez
I'm not sure if it's conducted by Zappa or who's conducting, but I think Ionization will be on that album. If we might be able to listen to it. That's all I know, really.
Does that help?
Yes.
Question. It's just an observation, really, based on some of the conversations around chance operations. A lot of discussion I've read up on about John Cage and indeterminacy and the fact that John Cage still determined the indeterminacy, and there's lots of interesting conversations around that. I wondered if you might comment on the fact that I think it was the second presentation you talked about Zappa being really keen to exist as a composer in relation to his musicians, and he controlled that the chance procedures, chance sort of processes. And interestingly, in the Geoffrey Farmer, we have chance operations which are far more similar to John Cage, when he sets up an algorithm and leaves it going. I just wondered if you kind of, just from your experience of the piece, just thinking about Zappa as a composer, just sort of any other thoughts on that. Farmer is a sort of Frank Zappa's kind of there. It's almost like he's been cut out of the photograph, but you have everything else around him. There's a real difference of approach there.
Now, I mean, if I kick off, what you might be alluding to the comment I made towards the end, which, for me anyway, where John Cage tried to take away the intentionality of the composer. I don't think he was interested in that, but he was interested in taking away the intentionality of the musicians. And the techniques such as Xenochrony, like me and Richard mentioned, that was a technique where he had control over how he manipulated the musicians, regardless when they played. So there was a number of albums which came to a head, I suppose, in the You Can't Do That on Stage Anymore series, the six-part series, where he literally took recordings, live recordings that were recorded decades apart, and the whole point of it that I could see was that the composer and the compositions were king. It didn't matter who played on them. So it's a slight, as you say, it's a different approach to the way that John Cage thought about using that. I don't know if anybody else has got anything to add on that.
Well, I mean, it's all about personalities, I think. That's kind of what you're saying. Mm-hmm. Zappa's music is full of personalities of his band members, not just in the fact that he recorded them improvising, but also they occasionally pop up vocally and all kinds of things like this. So you kind of get to know the members of his band and you get to know what they're like. Unlike John Cage, who, well, it's kind of different because Cage was trying to remove the personality of the composer from the music, so you get the performer's personality. But I don't know, I think ultimately with John Cage you end up with a piece that's instantly identifiable as John Cage, so his personality is still completely there. So maybe Zappa succeeds more in that sense because you get to hear some other people. I don't know.
Do we have any more hands up yet?
Yeah, I just wanted to. You mentioned earlier about the each concert. It was basically impossible for it to ever be the same because he would constantly change the set list, and then within each song, it's random or there's where he's sort of changing it up. I've come to this exhibition about 4 separate times and just spent about half an hour in each, just to try and, you know, beginning of the day, end of the day, to try and almost like catch the exhibition out, you know, just to see, oh yeah, there's the same bit. I haven't found a bit yet. But there's the one bit that makes me feel like, oh, this is Frank Zappa, is the cactus. That's I don't know whether it does, and I haven't seen it, but whether it actually does hit the chimes, it does.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
Oh my God, I'm just going to have to spend the whole time here. I've been waiting for it to hit it. But okay, all right. Well, I was going to ask anyway. But that kind of you're predicting it's going to hit the chimes, and well, for me, although my mind has just been blown now, that, you know, it does actually. Yeah, that kind of it has a humour to it. Well, what I thought it was, it would always just about touch it, and seemingly never did. Yeah, that kind of Frank Zappa would play with the audience, and it sounds like he played with his musicians in that sense, that kind of anticipation and humour. But I know humour is a big thing for Frank Zappa, and I wondered if you could comment on that in terms of the exhibition as well.
Yeah, there were a few things that made us laugh when when we were watching it. I think one thing you're saying there, which I quite often do with my students, is slightly avoiding the second part of the question, but in terms of the expectancy of Zappa's music, obviously there's a whole generation out there who aren't aware of Zappa's music, really, and I make a point a few times a year of introducing them to Zappa. And it's really interesting listening to some of the music. Ask, like Richard was saying, there's a certain expectation in the vast majority of pop music where you just know what's going to happen. In Zappa's music, certainly when you hear it for the first time, it's virtually impossible to tell what's going to happen next, either within a song or even in some albums. You don't know what style the next track's going to be in. And even between albums, you don't know what style the next album's going to be in.
And even with the same album, if you get the vinyl version and then you get the CD version, they're different.
slightly different. So the expectancy is, and you've sort of got that in this installation. You've just demonstrated that there is the cacti. And you're sort of expecting it, and sometimes your expectations are fulfilled when you're actually there, and sometimes they're not. I did see it happen, but I don't know if it was on video or when we were there. I can't remember now, but I have seen the cacti.
Yeah, it did happen earlier.
Yeah.
And only hit about the first five and then went back when I saw it. Yeah.
It wasn't the whole.
No, it wasn't the whole. Yeah,
And I don't think I was in there long enough to sort of capture the humour as an entity, but there were certainly some sounds, some strange sort of sticks moving around and stuff, which were just funny. I don't know why, but they were just humorous.
I think with the humour, I mean, it is that sort of surrealist humour as well, that, as you say, the unpredictability and the surprising juxtaposition. But as a figure, I mean, he was, again, it's his eclecticism. He presented Saturday Night Live a couple of times and appeared on, you know, equivalents of sort of blankety-blank style shows in the 70s. I mean, it's absolutely extraordinary. You know, he really was appearing in all kinds of contexts and all kinds of humour in that regard.
He was on the Monkees, wasn't he?
Yeah, that's right, absolutely, yeah.
Imagine that.
I think that's what makes him so complicated. That might be one of the things that influences Farmer. The fact that he could be on the US equivalent of blankety blank, and the next minute he's got Pierre Boulez conducting his classical works. There's just this, who is Frank Zappa? You know, he's got so many personas, it's difficult to tell. He never gives himself away either. There's this theory which is around in academic circles called strategic anti-essentialism, and it's the idea that you present characters in your music that are otherwise you believe them, but you don't present them as you present them via a persona, and Zappa did that all the time. He was never himself. He always put on a front, and that's something else which sort of makes the mystique of who he was all the more intriguing, really.
And interesting that Geoffrey also said that he was kind of using Zappa as a way of saying something else. It kind of fits with that strategic.
That's interesting.
In essentialism. I know that this gentleman in the third row, you had your hand up first.
Thank you.
I was just thinking in terms of indeterminacy in recorded music, how useful a concept that is to apply to recorded music, in the sense that you can have all these processes that Cage and Zappa might have used to come up with the sounds that get recorded, you know, throwing dice, using the I Ching, using the, sorry, what was it called, the sing clavier.
Sing clavier.
And similar things. But at the point at which that recording's made, at the point at which the CD is pressed or the vinyl is, sorry, whatever vinyl used to be, however vinyl used to be made, the music is fixed. And a listener comes along and listens to that. And no matter how it was produced, that music is now determined and always will be. And I was just wondering whether indeterminacy is useful as an interpretative tool or whether it sort of just ceases to be meaningful at that point.
Mm. It's an interesting question. I'm going to hand it over to
Thanks.
Richard to start off.
Well, where to start? Blimey. Okay, well, I'm thinking, my brain is currently thinking, and I can't get him out of my head, is Derek Bailey. I don't know if you know who Derek Bailey is, but he was a free improviser who detested really recording his music, but he had a record company and recorded all his music. So it's kind of the moment where the art is being made kind of is when it's being made, and in a sense, the recorded thing is a document of that event. I don't know if that helps, but I mean, I think that's what it is really with music. I mean, we purchase it, we buy the stuff, we stick it on our CD players and listen to it. But in a way, for that kind of music where it's very much unpredictable and it's improvised or it's indeterminate, the performance when it's happening is where it's at, and everything else is, you know, just a record company making a product and people buying it. So I don't know if that, does that answer any question there at all? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I guess it can, you can easily apply it to live performance and so on and so forth. Mm. But it's just, when you think of recorded music, like you played the two examples, mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. There could have been any number of indeterminate procedures that went through to that, but when you press play, well, we might not.
Well,
you can play
a record as many times as you like. It's not going to change, is it? I mean, that's,
exactly.
Yeah. Mm. But I mean, I think this kind of comes back to this idea of weighing up unpredictability with predictability, and thinking about maybe a more structural point of view. I mean, unpredictability works on lots of different levels. So there's predictability, I can't help it. So you can listen to a song from perspective and kind of, your brain maybe subconsciously kind of knows that you've kind of all heard a rock beat before, so you kind of know the snare's coming down on the 2 and the 4 or something like that. So that's one level of predictability. You get over that pretty quickly because you kind of know that that's going to happen. So then it becomes onto a slightly higher, different hierarchy, maybe the verse or the chorus, and you kind of listen to that and you know where that's going. I don't know what my initial, where I was going with that now, I've kind of lost my point.
I mean, what I would say to add to that is that with Zappa, it still had the capacity of being changed. He did various versions of the same piece of music. Quite often he would be constantly reproducing his music as well, remixing it, and that went on all the way through to the time that he died. So I think, you know, it would have still had the capacity to be changed, even if it had been produced into a record. There can be further changes. For example, you know, there's a huge tribute band phenomena with Zappa at the moment. Mm-hmm. There's a festival in Bad Dobrum in Germany, which is just dedicated to Frank Zappa, called Zappanali, 4 days of Frank Zappa's music, where his music has been rearranged again by people who range from, you know, local musicians, but also a lot of Zappa alumni attend that, where the project object is being extended into the present day. It's still continuing to change.
So I guess that kind of leads to further questions, which is kind of going to go off the topic now, but sort of, when is a work a work, when is a work finished, and so on and so forth. But I don't want to hog the mic, so I'll pass it on. Thank you.
I think there might have been Is there somewhere else, someone else waiting? Yep, yep, they're in the front.
Yeah, okay. Just a couple of things. You mentioned some of the influences on Zappa. How influential was someone like Nietzsche on Zappa? The reason I mentioned that is because Nietzsche also famously didn't need an audience, not really. And you could ask, not only was Zappa almost dismissive of musicians, they were just tools to be used. Did he really need an audience? I mean, would he have performed to himself? It seems to me that what he really was trying to do is surprise himself over and over and over again, rather than surprise anyone else. In other words, the surprise began and ended with Zappa. Just an observation.
He wrote music for himself, I think, first and foremost. Yeah. And
he liked to be surprised.
Yeah, and the relationship with Nietzsche, I think, the famous God is dead maxim. Zappa, of course, said jazz isn't dead. It only smells funny, but it's a play on Nietzsche's God is dead.
But there's an ambiguity with the audience, isn't there? I mean, like with the Halloween ones, I mean, it did seem really important to him, and, you know, him saying to the band, look, it's Halloween, it's New York, act accordingly, this has got to be the big one. You know, that there was a real...
Audience participation was a big part of it all as well.
Yeah.
Because you don't know what a member from the audience is going to do. Mm-hmm. Anybody invited up on stage could do anything. He'd ask them to do the most perverted things he could think of and find out if they do them or not. Mm-hmm. I think the audience was drawn upon just to add that bit of spontaneity and that bit of what's going to happen now to the live shows.
And in the Baby Snakes film, when he's looking at the costumes in the audience, isn't he, and talking to them about them, and the tackier the better.
I mean, sorry, it just strikes me, because there's also a connection here again with Wagner and Nietzsche and the whole kind of clownish, almost unpredictability of the Nazis. I mean, this whole thing about speed and striking out of... Napoleon was a similar sort of character. Even the way he made war in Europe was unpredictable, which is why he won so many early victories. It's this constant thing of surprise, which seems to unite some of these personalities. It'd be interesting to see, and I don't know enough about Zappa, but if someone's actually written any, looked at some of the psychology of Zappa.
Yeah, it's fascinating. I certainly get the impression that he certainly wrote music for himself, and he also seemed to look at his audiences with a degree of contempt.
Mm.
He thought they were stupid.
Absolutely.
He could manipulate them to do stupid things, and they would buy it every time, you know. And he could even get them to buy orchestral music and think it was pop music.
Mm.
It was, I think this is the way that he...
Puppet master,
yeah.
Thanks very much.
But again, with that banter with the audience, I mean, there's some concerts where he did perform with his back to the audience the whole time, isn't there?
Mm.
You know, but in the same venue 2 months later would be like a stand-up comedian almost, engaging.
Yeah.
Mm.
I think we've got time for one more question, and there's another one on the front row.
You made several references to aspects of Zappa that haven't yet come into the public arena. Rage and the Fury, Dance Me This. And there's a sense, isn't there, that his legacy, which he always claimed to have no concern for at all, or in fact sometimes said, people will forget me as soon as I'm gone, evidently not true. But there's this very strong sense that his legacy is being controlled. And I'm noticing Paul nodding vigorously, perhaps because his programme notes for the 200 Motels event at Royal Festival Hall were pulled at the last minute.
That's right.
Dweezil Zappa, performing his father's music, is doing a kind of tidied-up version. You will not hear him performing jazz discharge party hats or anything of a similarly controversial nature. Have you got any thoughts about the dangers of people, even if they're the widows of a composer, trying to control the legacy in such an overt way?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I actually wrote a paper a couple of years ago, which was published on, I can't remember the exact title, but it was called An Autocratic Approach to Music Copyright, the Case of the Zappa Family Trust.
That's what we did, though.
Yes, it was, actually. That's why my programme notes didn't make it to the final stage. But it wasn't really a direct criticism of the Zappa Family Trust, to be honest. It's the whole notion of how one person or one organisation can have the sort of control over a legacy. In particular, when you look at the way Zappa freely used popular culture at large. You know, he quoted freely from pop music, Louis Louis, Stravinsky, so on and so forth. He used popular culture in such a creative way, yet his legacy is restricting that. And it became interesting to me when tribute bands were being sent cease and desist notices to basically stop playing the music. And, you know, if you listen to Joe's Garage, for example, the whole idea of Joe's Garage is you don't want that to happen, a sort of a Orwellian society, a Big Brother society where music is illegal. And here is his own organization making his music illegal. And I just had real problems with, and still have real problems with that, although, you know, they're doing a great job in releasing his music, and I've got great respect for that, but I think there's a way to do it, which I'm, you know, I didn't and still don't agree with the way that happens.
I don't think it's just Zappa plays Zappa not playing, what was it again, jazz discharge party hats. I think it's also the classical music as well. Mm. I mean, I think it's been, I don't know. I mean, when I heard the went to the 200 Motels concert, and I'm my experience of watching the film of 200 Motels is it's kind of quite bawdy humour, to say the least. And it's completely removed from this 200 Motels suite, which is now the current format of the music, the orchestral music from 200 Motels. So it kind of makes me feel something's going on here. They're trying to make him a proper composer again, you know. And you know, he was a very good composer, but I happen to think that there are other orchestral composers out there who are better than Frank Zappa. And so, yeah, that's it. I think his orchestral music's better when it is mixed in with all the other stuff. I think that's where his art works. It's that kind of gelling of the rock and the jazz and the orchestral stuff.
I think there's the cultural shift, though, and technological shift, because, I mean, most of the release works are on Spotify now, aren't they?
Yeah.
Which is absolutely unthinkable just a couple of years ago, isn't it, when they were vetoing any presence like that, but suddenly it's all there for free, you know.
On iTunes as well.
On iTunes, yeah. So a change is being forced with it, I think.
I think there was a danger, you know, that he would just become invisible.
Because you couldn't hear it.
No. You just couldn't get access to the music, even via a pub band. If you played it and you were a pub band, you'd be, you know, threatened with a legal notice.
I just want to say, I could probably make myself feel it anyway. I was going to say that, in a way, he's an antithesis on rock music, which is famously very predictable compared with jazz. And with a more creative, experimental end which classical finally went into. Which, you know, Stockhausen, people like that, and as you say, ultimately John Cage, you know. I mean, it was almost as if he was defying what was always considered kind of a rock fan. Was he? I mean, he was actually reacting against that, wasn't he? He was saying, I'm not this. I'm trying to, you know, trying to do something else here, which is, if you like, you know, worship the unpredictability of jazz in its pure forms. You know, and indeed more experimental class. But, you know, rock music is very predictable.
Mm. Absolutely.
It's not falling, so, actually. Mm. One of the real things against it.
Yeah, he said he always put across that he didn't particularly like jazz, but there's recordings coming through now where his early recordings, in fact, Let's Make the Water Turn Black was originally a jazz recording with trumpet and saxophone. Yeah. It was originally an archetypal sort of jazz piece.
Awesome, over.
Obviously not the big band sound, because that is really tall.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Thanks.
It's okay. I think were there any more responses to that? Or I was gonna draw things to a close. And thank you very much, Richard and Paul. And thanks also very much to the audience for being here and for raising questions and having us have this discussion. So thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca. I'm sorry, you overran a bit.
Don't worry. I don't